Amen. If you will, turn with me to, if you've got it there on your page, or if you were to look with me, the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 12, verse 9. How many of you have your Bibles tonight? Hold up your Bibles if you got them. That way I can see who's saved and who's not. I'm just kidding. You can put them down. I know who best to pray for. No, I really do want to encourage you. Always bring God's word with you. I think it's really awesome that we have electronic devices that we can download the Bible, but I do think it's still not a bad idea to tangibly have the Word of God with you in book form. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, we've been focusing on this scripture a little bit. We're going to kind of finish out this teaching about healing over the next couple of weeks and move on to some of the other gifts, because they all, I believe, need time to ask questions and to be able to let God's word just give clarity in these ways. But it says in 1 Corinthians 12, 9, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit. And we've talked about these gifts of healing a little bit. We're going to talk kind of more about the practical side of about it, about putting this into practice in our daily lives. In the book of Mark, y'all may be familiar with this scripture. We've looked at it a couple of times. Mark chapter 16, verses 15 through 18 says this, that he, who was Christ, said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well. Can I get an amen? I love this passage of Scripture because it's not only instructional, but it's inspirational. It's saying, I hope that you don't look at this as just like, this is what we're supposed to do, but this is what we get to do. This is amazing things. I really do believe there has been a falling away in our civilized culture, in a lot of first world countries. There's been a falling away in faith because we have lost our awe. We've lost our amazement about the things of God. We've gotten a little bit too liturgical sometimes, a little bit too sterilized, and I just hope that you know and believe that God is still God. He still does wonders and miracles today. Amen. And that's something that we should never explain away or take for granted or ignore. And that's what I'm really praying, that the Word of God will challenge you and it will inspire you to get involved as the body of Christ. That last part of verse 18 is what we're really going to focus on tonight. That says they will place their hands on sick people and they will get well. This first part, I want you to write down your answer to that first question, which is, why is laying hands on people significant? And just in your own words, you don't have to be a PhD in theology or Bible-ese or whatever, but just take a moment, and I encourage you, really do write something down so you can kind of look at what your thoughts are. Why do you feel that laying hands on people is important, is significant? And once you've written something, I'd like to hear from one or two of you at least, maybe your thoughts, which I can tell by the look on your face just made some of you really think more about what you're writing. Would somebody be willing to share your thoughts before we actually go in and look at what Scripture says? What is maybe your knee-jerk answer to that question? Yes, sir. Say that a little bit louder. It's physically what they did back then. Yeah, it was done in Bible times. That's a great answer. Fair answer. Anybody want to add to that or expound on that? Yes, ma'am. Amen. Yeah, it's God's word that says where you agree and touch. Somebody else had their hand up. Yes, sir. I think it is. I mean, it's obviously instructed in Scripture. And so I want to talk about it for just a moment before we go any further. Think about laying hands on people. We typically, if you're from a Pentecostal background or have been around a Pentecostal church, you might be comfortable with this or maybe commonplace to you. But not all denominations, not all churches practice this really, or at least they don't talk about it all that openly. But it is in Scripture. But think about this. This gets into that realm for some people where Christianity gets a little bit uncomfortable, gets them out of their comfort zone a little bit. You know what I'm saying? We are the society of hand sanitizer. Amen. Sometimes you talk about laying hands on people and they're like, could you lay hands on me without using your hands? Is that a way that we could do that? I'm just gonna pray real hard in your direction. Use the force spiritually. But there is something very important. There is something spiritually significant to the laying hands on people. Look at that next verse of Scripture in Genesis chapter 2. Way back at the beginning, think about this. It says in verse 7 that then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Now, just think with me about this for just a second. What did God do when he formed man out of the ground? Just common sense. What did he do there? He did. He used his hands. Anybody ever play in dirt? Apparently my kids like to see how much dirt they can hide somewhere on their body when they play in it. We've got a little kind of hole that, I don't know why my oldest child just decided one day that our house needed a hole. I don't remember. He just said he had this shovel, like our big shovel. He got out of the garage and he's dragging it. It's like, what are you doing with that shovel? And he's like, oh, I'm going to help dig a hole in the backyard. I was like, help? Thanks. I didn't know I needed help with that. But he felt like that would help our house somehow. And so there's this big just dirt spot in the backyard where they love to play. And even Olivia, even our baby girl, she loves to get down there and get her hands. There's something satisfying. I don't know why it is, man. It just feels good to just stick your hands in the mud or your feet sometime. You know, if you know, you're not into that sort of thing, you know, don't think I'm too weird. But I just, sometimes it feels good. I remember as a kid, like Play-Doh and things like that. You can't not touch Play-Doh. You know, like everybody has Play-Doh and you're like, oh, can I see some of that? And I want to make something out of it. And God here, when he made humanity, when he was forming man, he was forming the first person. It says that he formed them from the dust of the ground. You don't form from the dust of the ground without using your hands. He got his hands dirty. He through that touch was what started the process of giving us life. And think about how he created everything else. What did he do? He spoke. It says he said, let there be light. He said, let there be birds in the air. But for humans, there is something significant, and it started at the very beginning from God. We were the first being, the first creation, and we're the epitome of his creation, it says, that he actually formed with his very own hands, that he touched. And that second part, I mean, you think about it, I'm not trying to get too personal, but you breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. God breathed into Adam the breath of life, and then he became a living being. If you've ever seen someone do CPR or, you know, breathe into them, you've got to get up close and personal with someone. And now please don't misunderstand me. Next time we have an altar call and I say somebody come up and lay hands on people, don't get in their face and try to breathe in their nose. That's not what I'm telling you to do. Just for clarity's sake, some of y'all are really good at obeying instructions, and I don't want to give you the wrong ones. But it is shown right here in the beginning that God was up close and personal with us. Now, I think it's significant. I think it's, actually has more spiritual significance than many of us realize, that as a society, we're becoming more and more disconnected with people. Physically. Think about it. Like, We now have FaceTime and things on phones where you can interact with one another, but you don't actually have to be near one another. You know, and in some ways that's a good thing. If someone's overseas, if they're in the military or at school or whatnot, those are good things. But what's bad is it's starting to happen. You can be, I know some of y'all don't do this because y'all, you know, are much, much holier than I am. Anybody ever texted somebody in your family and they were in the next room? Because you just didn't want to holler out. Don't raise your hand, brother. I'm trying to help you out. But you know what I'm saying? We do these things, and it's almost comical. I mean, it's funny, but if we're not careful, we will condition ourselves. I'm a bit of a germaphobe. I'll just be straight with you. I don't, anytime, you know, if I'm ever at a restaurant and the waiter touches, like, the pointy part of my fork or my spoon, you just need to throw that bad boy away. You know, I don't care if it's metal, whatnot. We actually, there was a minister's wife who I know would eat with my parents sometimes, and she would carry like the Lysol or whatever that sanitizer is and would clean the silverware everywhere she went, which made me feel better because I thought I was, you know, paranoid, but apparently there's someone worse. But there's those things that, you know, you're just looking at them and wondering, you know, why are you touching my stuff or why are you touching me? If somebody bumps into the other day, I had someone. It was an elderly gentleman at Walmart who was talking to me while we were standing in line, and it was like he was getting real close to that breathing into my nostrils to give me the breath of life. You know, it was just like, brother, you know, arm's length is good. That's my natural tendency in some ways. And I'm not saying that we need to invade each other's space or be rude or overstep boundaries. But it is very important when it comes to these spiritual matters, when it comes to, you know, this topic we've been discussing, that this means war. We're in a battle. You want to be very close with your brothers and sisters who you're going into battle with. You want to know you can trust them. And that they care about you and you care about them. And I do believe it's a tactic of the enemy of our soul to get us more and more disconnected, to get us less and less personal, less and less caring. You know, and we do it in the church world. We see each other, how you doing? Great. You know, praise God, good. You know, we're not even emotionally connecting with people sometimes, you know. You just want to let them say, well, just read what I said on my Facebook. Doesn't my life look good? Why are you judging me? You know, you liked my picture. Don't you think my life is going good? You know, that's kind of how we do to one another. And it's so important to get beyond that, get past that. And a key truth that I want you to remember, this is on the back page if you want to fill in the blanks, is that there is something powerful about the power of touch. There's something powerful about the power of touch. And I'm not about to preach to you, you know, some mysticism or some New Age thing. This is going to be the Word of God. How many of you believe the Word of God is true? It's given for our good. It's given for our instruction, our example. So I really want you to just prayerfully be ready to walk through these verses of Scripture tonight, because I think God wants to do something impactful in those of us who are hearing this message. I think that you're not here by accident or coincidence, and the Lord's going to speak to you about something. He may help you tonight with something that's going to allow you to help somebody else down the road. In Mark chapter 8, verses 22 through 25, and I encourage you, you know, don't just look at these on the paper, but study these during the week. Get your Bible out and let God's Word speak to you. Never just take, you know, anything I say for, you know, for granted or anything. We always want to make sure it's backed up by God's Word, and God's Word shows us some good things. In verse 22, it says, they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to what? Touch him. That word, that's why I really like how the New International Version describes this, but it says it the same way in other translations. They begged Jesus. They were trying to get him. They were desperate for Jesus to touch this man who was blind. It says that he took the blind man by the hand. Notice that he initiates touch with him from the beginning and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes, now that's getting a little too personal there, Jesus, but just hang with me. He had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him. Jesus asked, do you see anything? He looked up and said, I see people. They look like trees walking around. Some of you may be familiar with this account. Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. This is just an eyewitness account of Christ healing someone from blindness. And notice all throughout, it's very personal, it's very interactive, it's very, he takes the man by the hand, leads him outside the village. That shows trust that man would be led by him. He had spit on the man's eyes and had put his hands on him and said, do you see anything? And something, too, I want you to notice is this man at first says, I see people. They look like trees walking around. So Jesus once more put his hands on the man's eyes. We're going to come back to that. But it says, then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Let's look at another example, and we're going to kind of build on these. Mark chapter 7, these first three just all come from the book of Mark. It says that Mark chapter 7, verse 32, there some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. There it is again. After he took him aside, away from the crowd, what happened in that first account? Where did he lead the blind man, the man that couldn't see? Outside the village. Just notice that. Then this other man, it says, he took him away from the crowd. Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Okay, I'm just going to pause here and ask the Lord that he would never call me to do something like this, I hope and pray. Or he's going to have to heal me from my germophobia before I ever do this. But watch what Jesus did. Because really, y'all, I'm not saying this to make fun or to make light of what our Savior did. But Jesus is our example, correct? And so many times people say, well, I don't want to do that. I don't want to talk to them. I don't want to pray for them because I'm going to feel uncomfortable. What was Christ willing to do for us? I mean, he was willing to walk in shame, being beaten, being disrobed in front of people, being tormented for us. And I tell you, if you really want to see somebody healed in your family, in your life, if you really want to see somebody's life changed, it may require you to get a little bit uncomfortable. It may require you to get outside your comfort zone and let God use you to reach out to them. Amen? Jesus here says he puts his fingers in this man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Now, we've talked about this with other biblical accounts, but that end game is so awesome. This man who was deaf and could hardly speak, it says his ears were open. Not only that, his tongue was loosed, and he began to speak plainly. All that happened instantly because of the power of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. That's Bible. So God is still capable of this. And what are we called in Scripture? We are the body of who? Jesus Christ. We are his hands, his feet. We are capable of these things because Jesus Christ is Lord. But I got to get us to understand, if we want to get to that last part of seeing these people healed and delivered, we've got to be willing to do whatever God asks us to do. It makes me think of in the Old Testament, Naaman, when he was asked to go dip himself in the Jordan River 7 times. And first he thought that was foolish. He said, well, we've got much nicer rivers closer here that I could just go to. And his servant said, look, if they'd asked you to do something crazy or a difficult thing to do for your healing, would you not have done it? And that's when he said, okay, let's go get in the Jordan River. He dipped 7 times. The first 6 times, nothing happened. And y'all, you may have been praying for somebody over and over and over. You may have been praying for yourself over and over and over. We even see in that first example that Jesus Christ, that first man that he spits on his eyes and lays his hands on him, the guy couldn't even see clearly the first time. I think this is Jesus showing us, don't ever give up your prayer. Don't ever give up your faith in God. Keep on pressing on and pressing forward to God's will. Because God's will, the Bible says, is that no one should perish. That's the will of God. That's what Scripture says. God did not make us to be sick. God did not make us to be defeated. It's time we stop accepting what sin has brought into the world and start seeking what God's real purpose is for this world. Amen? I'm tired of being defeated. I'm tired of watching people just struggle to even make it in their faith. I'm afraid so many people are falling away in their faith because we allow our faith to get stagnant and weak. And we don't even really give God a chance to do what he's really capable of because we're not willing to put ourselves out there. You know what it takes to really have faith? Risk. It does. It doesn't take faith if you can see all the answers, if you can see all of, you know, the situation in full. So if you really want to step out in faith, it's going to require you to take risks. It's going to require you to get a little bit uncomfortable. But I want to see what God is capable of doing through my life. So I'm praying he will give me the boldness to do more than I've ever done. I pray that for you, that we will be able to reach out to people in a way unlike we ever have. Because there is something powerful about the power of touch. It's how God created us. He formed us in the first place. It's how he breathed his breath of life into us. And I think that's why Satan has tried to cause our society to be uncomfortable with touch, to be uncomfortable with people invading our space or even our emotions. We're so guarded of all these things. And sometimes we've just got to confess and we've just got to let go and just get it all out in the open so that God can heal us. That's what God's word says, that if we confess our sins to one another, that's how we're healed. Look with me now at Mark 5. Kind of a theme here. We're walking backwards through the book of Mark. But again, Christ is our example, so I'm just going to let him preach. He's going to do a lot better job than I ever could. Verse 22 through 30 says that then one of the synagogue's leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him. Notice all three of these examples. They begged him to touch them. This man pleads earnestly. My little daughter is dying, he said. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She'd had an issue of blood. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. Church, I'm thankful for good doctors. I'm especially thankful for godly doctors. But the most godly of doctors will tell you something. I had a man, he's a Christian doctor, I know him very well, and he said, I always want you to remember something. They call it practicing medicine for a reason. You may have heard that before. At the end of the day, doctors who really are being truthful with you know that there is someone greater than them who all this really depends upon. We use our wisdom, we use, you know, God gave us a brain, and we want to give the best, of modern medicine, and you want to be smart and wise in your decisions and healthy in your eating habits and exercise habits, things of that nature. But at the end of the day, without Jesus, it's all a moot point. Amen? And this woman had gone to these doctors. She had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. Verse 27, when she heard about Jesus, man, that'll preach. When she heard about him, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. There's that touch again. Because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" You notice in a theme here, every time Christ heals somebody, almost without fail, in fact, about the only instance where Jesus does not physically touch somebody is the Roman centurion when he says, look, you don't even have to come to my house. It's not that he didn't want him to touch him. He just said, I know you don't even have to. It's not that he didn't believe in laying on of hands, but his faith was so great. He said, I don't even need you to come. You can touch her right from where you're at. And that's the big picture I want you to get, is that we are an extension of the hands of Jesus Christ. The reason we're called the body of Christ is not just so we can say, well, we're holier than those that aren't saved, or we're better than anybody else. It's because we are supposed to take up His ministry, His mantle, if you will, with our time here on this planet. God does not leave us here. Once you get saved, you're not left here and not instantly beamed up to heaven for no reason. You're left here to show in a real, tangible way the love of Jesus Christ to those around you. And this world is in desperate need of healing. It's in desperate need of physical healing, but also emotional and spiritual healing. There's so many people. All of us here represent somebody, a lost loved one, a neighbor, a friend, somebody who, if they died tonight, they would spend eternity apart from God in hell. And that should trouble us. That should concern us. That should make us realize we're in a war. We're in something that it's life and death. And to the extreme, it's eternal life. It's eternal death. And it's so important. And church, we want to use every weapon at our disposal. These gifts of the Holy Spirit we've been talking about, again, they're not just to make us feel good. The army doesn't go off and set off the atomic bombs in their home base, right? Nobody sets off an A-bomb in their you know, where there's civilians or where they're training. That's only really determined for the war. And sometimes we only operate in the spiritual gifts around other believers in church. Y'all, that's not what these are really intended for. Now, we should edify one another, build one another up, you know, by the use of these gifts. We can heal one another all day and all those sorts of things. But y'all, if you believe in Jesus Christ, ultimately you're going to be healed in eternity. I've got faith in that. Amen? So we got to start using this stuff in the battlefield where it really can make an impact. And I'm saying we need to keep ministering to one another. Don't get me wrong, but we got to press on beyond these four walls. They need to know that there is still a God. They need to know not only is there some being, there's some deity above us, but He still cares for us so much that He would send His only begotten Son to die, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish but have eternal life. And some people can't believe that because they've gotten confused by what society or science or some false religion has said to them, and they just need to experience Jesus Christ for themselves, and that's where we come in. Is Jesus in us? We must decrease, He must increase, so people can see Christ in a real and a tangible way. I tell you, I could argue with you. I could try to read you facts and scriptures and things about that, about God. But until you have a personal experience, an encounter with God, it's going to fall short. But on the flip side of that, man, there is nobody that can ever tell me God is not real. He's done too much for me, and I've watched Him do too much in other people. And so when you have that encounter with God, your faith is on a different level. That's where these gifts of the Spirit come in, that faith that's given by the Spirit of God. When it comes from Him, it's not based on your emotions. It's not based on your situation. It's not based on comparing things with anybody else. It's based on Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's our goal here. All of these instances that we just looked at, some common things I want you to recognize. Obviously, the power of touch, this laying on of hands. I believe it is significant because of all the things you expressed earlier, because we're commanded to do this in God's Word, because, you know, it's showing our faith, our obedience to what God says. It also is so significant because it just shows that you care, you know? This last verse of Scripture, Matthew chapter 8, is where Jesus heals a man who had leprosy. It says in verse 1, when Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed Him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before Him and said, Lord, if You're willing, You can make me clean. Jesus reached out His hand and touched the man. I am willing, He said, be clean. Immediately, He was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, see that you don't tell anyone. And this part of Scripture always kind of puzzled me. See that you don't tell anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them. And I want us to talk about this a little. Let's discuss this together and ask God to help give us understanding. Why is it, you think, that Jesus said, don't tell anybody? but go show yourself to the priest, offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them. Think about that. Here's this guy, had leprosy. If you know culturally, lepers not only were not supposed to come up and touch you, they were supposed to warn you if you were coming near to them. They were supposed to yell, unclean, and they were supposed to stand at a distance and yell this so that you would know to stay away from them because it was highly contagious. It was a terrible skin disease that ultimately led to a painful death. And if they did not do this, they could be, you know, just killed on the spot. I mean, you could literally just, they could be stoned to death, or a soldier would slay them if they did not do this kind of a warning. This man comes up to Jesus and he just said, "Lord, if you're willing," his faith, I mean, he said, "You can make me clean." If only we would all come to God like this. We know, God, that you can help us. You can heal us. Too many times we go to the Lord in prayer thinking, "It's not going to happen this time. It didn't happen last time. It's not going to happen this time." We need to change that mentality. Come to God saying, "I know you can do it. You're capable. You're willing." Sometimes all he wants is us to allow him to do what he wants to do. God is a gentleman. He's not going to force anything on us. He could. He's powerful enough. He can do whatever he wants. But he's shown time and time again throughout Scripture, he gives us free will. He gives us the option of, will we allow him to work and move in our lives? But so let's again focus on that last part. Why in the world did Christ tell this guy not to tell anybody? Anybody want to weigh in what you think? Why would he say, "Don't tell anyone, just go quietly to the priest"? That was that was what you were to do. If you thought you were getting better, you would go show yourself to the priest. They would watch you for a few days. They would observe you. And then if in the allotted amount of time you were not getting worse, that you could go back to your family. Anybody have any thoughts on why this was significant? Yes, sir. I've read that as well, and I think that's a big factor. He was not yet making himself known to the masses. He was not yet kind of revealing that he was the Son of God. Of course, now other miracles had been performed at this point. It's kind of hard to, you know, keep. Any of y'all ever told somebody something that was really, really interesting, and you tell them, "Now don't tell anybody else. You know, you just, this is between you and me." Or you've had somebody do that to you. They say, "Well, don't tell anybody else." And then you play that same game with somebody else. You go, "Okay, I'm going to tell you this, but you can't tell anybody else." You know, and you, like 37 people that happens to. It's hard to keep things like that under wraps. And I've often wondered about this, about why would Christ say this? And I really believe that God spoke to me. I've read other schools of thought about this, but I believe the Holy Spirit kind of revealed something to me about this instance. And it's those final few blanks you have on your page that says, God wants us to have his power in our hands. God wants us to have his power in our hands. What I mean by that, or how that applies to this passage of Scripture, is think to several instances in the Bible, in the New Testament. Christ is our example, where he would just kind of look at his disciples like, "Do I have to do this for you every time?" You know, when even on the boat, when he said, "Peace be still," he turned to them and said, "How long will I be with you? At what point?" You know. And notice what he says to this man: "Go show yourself to the priest, offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them." What's he talking about? As a testimony to them. God at some point, and please understand what I'm about to say, I believe very deeply that God wants to put himself out of a job. Think what I'm saying there. When he first created us, again, we're trying to get back to perfection. We live in a sin-fallen world. When God made this earth, So many times people will say, well, why did God make sickness? Why did he make disease? Why did he didn't. There was none of that in the garden. There was none of that in the beginning. It doesn't say in the beginning God made chicken pox. He made chickens. He made people. All these things. But it was perfection. There was no sickness. There was no death. It says in heaven, same way, all tears will be wiped away. There will be no sickness. There will be none of that in heaven. We're going to get back to that point. So what changed? Sin entered the world. God didn't make sickness, but he made us and gave us the option, gave us the choice of choosing salvation or sickness, of healing or hell, basically, is our choice. We can be eternally healed or eternally in torment. And we get to choose because that's what the decision for love to exist requires. You can't really love somebody if they're forced to love you, you know, if you don't have a decision. So he gives us the power of free will. It's such a powerful thing. But God wants us to have his power in our hands. He wants to work himself. God doesn't want to have to perform miracles anymore, because you know what? If he's performing miracles, that means people are in need of a miracle. And he wants his children to always have enough. He doesn't want to have to heal you from any diseases anymore, because God doesn't really want you to have any diseases. Amen? Think about that. God doesn't need to show off. He doesn't need to prove he's God. And he's hoping that we will begin to obey his commands, that we'll begin to obey his laws, begin to obey his word. And I believe that's significant that it says, go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony. Show them this stuff works. Show that obeying the laws that God has given, the laws that are instituted in our natural world, they work. Have you ever studied the Old Testament, some of the dietary, some of the stuff, the eating plan that's given in God's word? This may shock you, but it actually has been scientifically and medically proven to be completely sound. Even people who are atheists, who are completely don't even really believe in God, will admit how fascinating it is that this book that was written and recorded thousands of years ago, the Old Testament especially, was written, you know, thousands of years ago, quite literally thousands of years, and it has stuff that dietitians are just now catching up to, about how certain foods, when you eat them, how they affect, you know, we're catching up to probiotics and things like that, you know, getting good bacteria, things of that nature. Did you know all that stuff is covered in God's word? God is smart. Hallelujah. He is good, and he is working on our behalf. At some point, church, we've got to just decide, are we going to listen to what he says and do what he says to do? And Christ here is such a great example of that, where he's, obviously he is God, you understand that, but as the Son of God, as God in the flesh, he always would defer to the Heavenly Father, correct? He always would glorify the Heavenly Father. He would say, I'm here doing my Father's will, I'm here doing my Father's business. Even as a child, that was his answer to people about what he was doing when he was teaching in the temple. They were marveling and amazing at this child who knew so much. They said, who is this young man that knows so much of the Word of God? And he says, I'm just doing my Father's business. Always pointed the glory back to the Heavenly Father. And even here, he's pointing glory back to God's Word. He's pointing glory back to God's will and his commands. And that's what we should be doing. We're sent out to be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ, to reach out to a lost and dying world. And ultimately, our job is to point them to the Father. And I tell you, if your motive is pure in that way, we read it in the book of James, and we're going to look at it a little bit later on in upcoming weeks, and we've looked at it before. God's word says, if our motive is in the right place, if we ask anything in the name of Jesus, it will be done for us. Does God's word lie? It never lies. The word of God is always true. And that same sentiment, that same spiritual truth is echoed in Scripture time and time again. It says, if your heart is aligned with God's will, nothing will be impossible for you, because nothing is impossible with God. Amen? I want to believe that. I want to live that. I want you to live that. Not so we can say that we're more spiritual than the church down the street or whatever. Y'all, there's not really supposed to be separate church. We're supposed to be the church. And I want to see the body of Christ unified and healed and delivered and going out doing what Jesus said. He said, if you're my believers, that in Mark chapter 16, these signs will accompany those who believe in me. That's what he says. We need to be out driving out demons. We need to be speaking in these new tongues, communicating with God in a spiritual language. We need to, in the name of Jesus, be able to pick up those spiritual snakes. And it says, if we drink anything deadly, it will not hurt us. We'll place our hands on sick people and they will get well. These things should be happening if we're followers of Christ. And I'm just wondering who's crazy enough, not in a bad way, who's bold enough, I should say, to believe the Word of God and to walk in it. This weapon of the gifts of healing, like I said, I think it's under attack by our culture, by our society. Satan doesn't want us to touch people, doesn't want us to reach out to people, makes it, you know, kind of creepy and feels awkward or uncomfortable to some people. And this is why I tell you, you need to stay in the Word of God. Don't listen to people's opinions. Don't listen to don't wait for your cues to come from culture. Let your cues come from God. Look, people will say stuff. We all the time, we give our opinions, we give our thoughts on things, we try to figure stuff out. We think we're so smart as humanity, you know, as we've come so far scientifically and all these things. We still don't know, you know, much of nothing about nothing. We do our very best, and with God's help, we make some advances, but he's the one who knows all things. I mean, when I was a kid, you know, this is why I tell you, always read God's Word and let his Spirit speak to you. It'll do better than me. When I was a kid, this makes me think of the science world. We sometimes just guess at stuff. Any of y'all not like to admit you're wrong? And if you're really caught in a situation you don't know the answer, you have the temptation to just make something up. I know y'all are way holier than I am, and you've never done that. But when I was a kid, a lot of people in our church, I have very curly hair. Some of y'all that know me, if I let my hair grow, I get an afro, like big and tough with my afro puff, you know. And it really is very curly. And my kids have some of that in their hair, not as much as I do, but I had big ringlet curls when I was a little boy and just blonde hair, very blonde. My hair got darker as I got older. Now it's getting lighter again. But you know what I'm saying? But I had these curls, and so many times adults would comment, I guess, you know, it was kind of crazy how curly my hair was. And people were always commenting about it to my parents or to me. And people would often ask me this question, which as a kid I didn't know the answer. They would say, where do you get your curls? Because my mom had curly hair because of perms, but not naturally curly hair. And my dad didn't have curly hair like I did. And they'd say, where'd you get your curls? And, you know, sometimes people ask stuff and they don't mean to. They would ask and creep me out, you know. I remember one lady, we were at church, and I didn't know her very well, and she said, I really want your curls. And all I could think of, I'd just been studying, like, the Wild West, and I thought this woman was going to scalp me. I really did. Like, it weirded me out. You know, I was like, you can't have them. But they would ask me, where do you get your curls? And you know what I told somebody? I didn't know the answer. Didn't want to admit that I didn't know the answer. And in my mind, I pieced some things together. In Walmart, there used to be hair displays. They may still do this. Or in beauty salons, things that, when they would show like the hair dyes, anybody ever notice sometimes they'll have a little curl of hair showing the different colors? Well, I put in my little smart, about 5-year-old brain, put 2 and 2 together and decided they have curls at Walmart. I bet you can get anything at Walmart. So I told these people, I started telling people, and it became a joke. Nobody corrected me because it was cute. It was cute to let me walk around and say, I got my curls from Walmart. But, I mean, people did just what y'all did. They would laugh at me. They would things. But you know what? After a while, I started to believe it. Nobody corrected me. Nobody ever told me that. And I was very offended when another child in one of my classes, the teacher or whoever, I don't remember, asked me, where did you get your curls? I knew they liked the reaction. I figured I had figured this out. I got them from Walmart. No, you did not. This little voice comes from behind me, and the fight was on. Yes, I did get them from Walmart. You know, it's like all these people said I did. Yes, I did. Isn't this just like humanity sometimes? We cannot fully understand the things of God. So we try to explain him away in stuff that makes sense to us. Y'all, if we could explain God away, we wouldn't need a Savior. He wouldn't be God, okay? We're never going to fully understand these things until we see him face to face someday. And so we need to stay in God's Word. Like I said, don't let society dictate what we believe or how we believe, but let's obey the Word of God. And Jesus is very clear. I mean, that healing comes from the laying on of hands. Back in, you know, and some people might say, well, that just sounds goofy or that sounds kooky or whatnot. Y'all, people want to say that it's not scientific. We're the same species that used to think that putting leeches on people to suck their blood out would get people well. We're the same species that has witch doctors in some cultures, that has, you know, all sorts of incantations, breathe. Now they don't have witch doctors in our culture. They call them essential oil salesmen. I'm just kidding. My wife loves essential oils. That was a dig at that. But you know what I'm saying? We have all these things. And really, some of those natural remedies, they're based on Scripture, a lot of them, about things that are done naturally. So I want to encourage you to, as Scripture said, seek the gifts of God. Seek the best gifts, God's Word tells us. And understand, the gifts of healing, they're not just for a certain person and for some people and not for others. It says these come by the Spirit, and he gives them to those that he determines. So it really is incorrect. Remember, we talked about that early. It's incorrect to say, well, I have the gift of healing or I don't have the gift of healing. Do you have the Holy Spirit? If you do, you have access to his gifts, all of them, and he will give them when he determines. He will allow you to walk in them and use them as necessary. I want to ask you if you would to stand with me as we dismiss tonight with prayer. And I hope this has been helpful. Is this okay? Is this talking about the Word of God? I know it's not a big shout them down message, but we need instruction from God's Word. And again, Christ is our best example. Look at what he did. The things he would do to reach out to help people, to show that he loved them. He did all of this before he even went to the cross. All this was leading up to that moment of he was willing to do whatever it took to see people saved, to see people healed. I want to ask you, if you're here tonight and you have a need in your physical body, or maybe you have an emotional need, you've just maybe been battling stress or anxiety or depression, whatever, you know, we need to quit being embarrassed to admit we need help and that we need God's touch in our life. Maybe there's even a spiritual battle that you are going through or somebody in your family. If you've got a need like that, would you be so bold just to lift your hand right where you're at? I want to ask those that are nearby just to pray with you. While you got your hands up, y'all look around. If there's somebody standing near you, will you just put your hand on their shoulder, something, just reach out and touch somebody. And I'm really not being silly. I'm serious. Let's do what the Word of God says, and let's agree together in prayer. And y'all, we're doing just what Jesus did. We're doing just as Christ instructed. We're going to lay hands on the sick, and I'm going to pray and believe that they will be healed. Anybody believe that with me tonight? Let's pray and just open your heart, open your own mouth, and let's all talk to God together. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of the man who came to the earth, God in the flesh, walked this earth, who is fully God and fully man, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray right now over these who they lifted their hands. They have a need in their life. They have a need in their body. They have a need in their heart or their spirit, whatever it may be, God. We pray right now for a healing virtue to flow to them right where they're standing, God. I pray in Jesus' name. Let them know that by those people standing there by them, by believers, followers of Christ, agreeing with them in prayer, that you yourself, God, are working on their behalf. You are praying for them. As God's Word says, Christ is always interceding for us. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. But right now, this is the way that in your Word, you have given us the ability to touch one another, to believe for healing. So we right now just speak the Word of God that says that they will place their hands on the sick and they will get well. They will be healed. We claim healing right now in Jesus' name. God, I pray that they would begin to feel your touch. They would begin to feel your spirit in their life, in their heart, whatever they have need of, God, you are the answer. And I speak and proclaim, I declare the healing power of Jesus Christ in this place, because you are still God, you are still on your throne, and you are greater than all of our needs, you are greater than all our problems. Be healed, I pray, in Jesus' name. And all God's people in agreement said, amen, amen. Will somebody give God praise for who he is? That he still is our healer. Praise God. Y'all are dismissed. Y'all are free to go. But please, if you've ever got any questions, you can always, you know where to find me here at the church, or you can get online and email or talk on the blog, whatever. God bless you, and go with God. Let's go out and be the hands and feet of Christ this week.